Praise God. Well, again, welcome to the house of God tonight. And Dillan asked me the order. I said I didn't have the order, but since you asked, you go in first. Praise God. Hallelujah. So there we're going to do it. We're going to do it that way. We're going to let brother, sister, brother. So we're going to let Brother Dillan, Pastor Dillan, come and start us off. They got 20 minutes each. And the theme of this service tonight, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches, Revelation 3:22. Someone say, hearing what the Spirit is saying to the churches. So I've not said anything to them. They've not said anything to me. So they've prayed and they've sought God. So what he is saying to them, that the church world, not just the church, but notice plural, churches, because this ain't the only church. God's got people everywhere. Thank God. Amen. He's got pastors and people, his people everywhere, our brothers and sisters. So, but God is saying something at this season to the church world, to his people, because judgment must first begin in the house of God. 1 Peter 4:17, and judgment there just means simply discernment. We must discern. We must hear what is God saying to his churches, because everything God's going to do in the world, he's first going to do in here. It also starts in the house of God. Somebody say it starts in the house of God. Ezekiel 47, Ezekiel saw the water, the river, the water coming out from under the altar. And he saw that within a house, because it said the Spirit of the Lord took him through the threshold of the door into the house. Somebody say the house of God. And then he saw the river of God, the move of God. Yes, God wants to move out there. He wants to move in the public. He wants to move in the streets. He wants to move anywhere in this world, but somebody say he's going to move in his house first. Everything he does anywhere else is going to issue from the house of prayer. It starts here. Even when Jacob saw, you know, the ladder go from earth to heaven in Genesis 28 and 12, and it's Jacob's ladder, many have called it, but Jesus in John 1:51 told Nathanael, he said, shortly hereafter, you'll see the Son of Man with angels ascending and descending upon him. And ain't that what Jacob saw of old? Angels ascending and descending upon the ladder, and God the Father standing at the top of the ladder, Jesus. Many call it Jacob's ladder. I just say Jesus is the ladder. He's the only way to God the Father, John 14 and 6. So when Jacob saw that, so many hundreds of years before Christ ever came, Jesus, amen, praise God, confirmed it, that what Jacob saw was not what, but who. He saw him. And because in the name of Jesus we pray, angels go to heaven with those prayers, and when we pray in Jesus' name, they come back down with answers. Somebody say there's only one name that heaven responds to when it comes to answer prayer. Somebody say it's Jesus. So it's a revelation of Jesus. But listen to what Jacob said in verses 17 of Genesis 28. And he described this place. He called it Bethel. Somebody say that means the house of God. In Hebrew is Bethel. He called that name that night where he had that dream and saw that ladder and saw that revelation. He said, this is none other than the house of God, the house, amen, that's God's. And he called it Bethel. And he said, this is none other than the gate of heaven. Somebody say the gate of heaven. Somebody say God's house, the gate of heaven. Don't that make sense? That's why Jesus said in Matthew 16 and 18, he said that the gates of hell shall not prevail against his church. The church that is built, founded on the rock, which is none other than Jesus. The revelation that he is the rock, he's the sure foundation, Isaiah 28:16 calls him. The Bible said in 2 Corinthians 10:4, Christ our rock. Somebody say he's the rock, he's the cornerstone. Amen. There's only one foundation that's been laid, and that is Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 3:21. Somebody say Jesus is the foundation. He's the rock. So when he said the gates of hell won't prevail against the church, against the revelation that he is the Son of the living God, that he's the rock, that he's the foundation, makes sense, don't it? Because back in Genesis, he said that his house, Bethel, the house of God, that's the gate of heaven. Where does God come down in the earth and do signs and wonders and miracles from? Somebody say at Bethel, at the house of God. So if you want to see God move in your life, somebody say you got to get predictable to the Bethel in your life, into the house of God, because God will say things here he's not going to say anywhere else. He's going to do things from here that'll never come from any other place. Amen. Praise God. Even the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost filled the place where the people were assembled together in a house, Acts 2:1-4. Somebody say they were in one place in a house, and the Holy Ghost filled the place, the house, then he filled the people. If you want the Holy Spirit to fill you, somebody say, you got to fill the house of God. You got to get connected, amen, to the Bethel, to the local Bethel, to the church, because that's the gate of heaven. Somebody say, that's where God comes down from heaven and moves in the earth. Everything starts within the house of God. So it makes sense to me, seven times throughout the book of Revelation, in Revelation 2 and 3, the churches at Asia Minor, God was speaking not only then to those churches, but he speaks to us today from those churches. Amen. And every one of them, seven times throughout Revelation 2 and Revelation 3, that statement is made. Let him that hath an ear hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the churches. Because if the churches ain't hearing from God, the world sure ain't going to hear from God. Because how are they going to hear? Through his churches. And if we're not hearing him, they're sure not going to hear him. And if we're not hearing God, I'm not doubting folks is hearing, but they're hearing not what of God, and they're declaring things that ain't from God, and that's what the world gets deceived by. Amen. Somebody say, so the church, it's imperative that we hear from God. We got to hear what he's saying to us, because so goes the church, so goes the world. Amen. Matter of faith, we're the only resisting force left here in, as the kingdom of God on this earth, that holds back his full judgment. And when he takes his church out of here, oh God, I wouldn't want to be here. Hallelujah. Amen. Because the wrath of the Lamb, according to Revelation 6 and 16, somebody say the wrath of the Lamb is going to be poured out on the earth. I don't know about you. I'm washed in the blood of the Lamb. He purchased his church with his own blood, Acts 20 and 28. So the blood of the Lamb, amen, saves me from the wrath of the Lamb that's going to be poured out here. So I'll not be here, and you won't either. The church that is blood washed will not endure the great tribulation, or there could be no tribulation. Come on, somebody. Because God not only saved our soul, he saved us from the wrath that is to come. 2 Thessalonians 1 verses 10. And how any way could you preach that as a hopeful message of his second coming than that way? How is there any hope any other way? Come on, somebody. Somebody say, we're not here. Just like back in Exodus during the first Passover, when the blood was applied, the Passover lamb's blood, somebody say, God delivered his people out of Egypt. And that same night, he judged Egypt where the blood was not applied. Amen. Praise God. But within Gothen, where God's people was at, they were preserved and they protected. Even in Noah's day, praise God, God preserved him and his family, the eight on the ark, from the flood. As the flood waters rose, somebody say, the ark was lifted up. Somebody say, we're going to be took out. We're going to be lifted up even, amen, during that time of judgment. We're not going to be among that is judgment. Come on. Amen. God didn't wash me in the blood of the Lamb to preserve me, to have the wrath of the Lamb poured out on me, because the blood already takes away the wrath of the Lamb. Come on. Hallelujah. So the Spirit of God is saying things to the churches, because the church has got to get rapture ready. She's got to stay rapture ready, and she's got to be the one that's doing like Revelation 22:17 in saying this, the Spirit and the bride say, come, and let him that hears come, and let him that's athirst come. Come on. Somebody say, come. Somebody say, the Spirit and the bride. What is the bride? Somebody say, that's the church that is intimate with the bridegroom. They're intimate with the one who purchased the church with his own blood. God said, just as a man, a husband, lays down his life for his bride, so did Jesus lay down his life for his bride. Amen. Ephesians 5:25. So everybody say, there's a close connection to the coming of the Lord, his cross, and his church. Jesus bled and died on the cross, amen, to birth his church. So you, if you neglect his church, you neglect his cross. The two go together. Amen. And when Jesus comes back, he's not coming back for a dater. He's not coming back for religious every now and then, or, amen, girlfriend. Come on, somebody. He's coming back for his bride that's been washed in the blood of his side. Hallelujah. Amen. And he's not going to leave his bride behind when he pours his judgment out. No, that's the whole purpose of the rapture. When he comes in the clouds, amen, 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17, we're going to be caught up, amen, as the dead in Christ rise first, then us that are alive remain going to be caught up with him, amen. And then we're going to hear Revelation 4:1 at that time, like John did. He said, I heard a voice sounds like a trumpet saying, come up hither. Then from Revelation 5 all the way through Revelation 19, seen, you find the saints all around the throne of God while judgment's being poured out on this earth during the great tribulation. Then at the end of that 7-year period, Revelation 19 is going to come to pass, and those who are washed in the blood of the Lamb, whose robes are washed in the blood of the Lamb, Revelation 7 and 14, somebody say, our garments are going to be white, amen, white robes, white linen, and they're the armies of heaven. They're going to be riding with him while he's saddled on a white stallion, coming back to judge and make war, and his name is called Faithful and True. And it will come to pass, like Jude said, amen, that Enoch prophesied, praise God, saying, the seventh from Adam, he said, I seen him coming, amen, with 10,000s of his saints. Oh, glory to God. Somebody shout, we're that army. We're going to come back first class. Amen. How can we come back with him? Amen. Glory to God, when he judges the earth in Revelation 19, if we hadn't done being caught up with him in the air, Revelation 4. Oh, think about it. Hallelujah. When he comes back in the clouds, that's the catch away of the church. But when he comes back after those 7 years and his feet hit the top of the Mount of Olives and it cleaves in two and he begins to judge. Come on, with the word of his mouth like a sword, and we're seen riding with him when he comes. Somebody say, at that time he'll come to the earth. Amen. When he comes in the clouds, that's as far as he's going, but that's to call the church up. Amen. Praise God. So everybody say, God is saying something about these times prior to that great event, that great day of the Lord's coming. That don't scare me. It gets me excited. Oh, somebody say, it ought to get you excited. I've had people say at the convenience store, oh, you got to go back and buy something else. It rung up $6.66. And I had one lady, she said, you ain't scared of that number? I said, no, ma'am, I sure ain't, because that's in Revelation 13, and the rapture's done happened by Revelation 4, so I won't be here. I ain't got to look for a mark of the beast. I ain't got to be concerned with it. Oh, the only name that's going to be in my forehead is going to be his name. Revelation 21 teaches us that. Oh, give him praise tonight. Hallelujah. Friend, he's coming. And we got to be prepared. We got to be ready, and we got to stay ready. That's part of being prepared. Amen. So God is saying something to his churches. And I promise you, if there's one thing he is saying, everything that else he's saying, it is to condition us and to get us ready for his soon imminent return. Preacher, if you ain't preaching about Jesus coming, you have missed the mark. Because everything we're talking about and speaking about is not only preparing people to leave this world through the grave, amen, but it's also to make sure people don't get left behind. Because I'm telling you, I'm not looking for an undertaker. The upper taker is, it could come at any time. Amen. Praise God. So hold fast to what God has given to you. Amen. Don't let any man take your crown, Revelation 3, verses 11, because we're in the end times, but it ain't time to end, and God is going to declare his word tonight. So, Lord, I speak your blood right now in the name of Jesus over Pastor Dillan. Speak your blood, Father God. Hallelujah. Over Prophetess Breanna, and I speak your blood over Pastor Tyler. Use him tonight for your glory in Jesus' name, and give us an ear to hear. Come on, son. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
First Corinthians 1:9 says, God is faithful, to whom he has called us all to the fellowship of Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the very first call we are all given, is to simply come to that fellowship. That's what he died for. Here's the thing. Jesus didn't die because he wanted visitation rights to us. Jesus died for us because he wants full custody of each and every one of his children. Amen?
Amen.
He don't want to just see us on Sunday. He don't want to just see us on Thursday night. You know, believe it or not, he actually wants to hear from you. He actually wants to talk to you. That's what he died for. No greater love than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends, John 15:13. He died for that friendship, that relationship. That's the cross connection. He didn't hardly talk to nobody except for the ones that he had specifically set in stone. And now he's like, he was longing just to talk to his people.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm going to send my son, my only son. I'm going to fix this. I'm going to fix what we did wrong, what we messed up in the garden. And it was just that simple word. What we messed up was the simple word of obedience.
Yeah.
Just simply obeying his word.
Yeah.
Amen. We get so sidetracked a lot of times. We're all guilty of it, and just simply obeying God's word. The whole time, when I found out, we're back here with the kids, and all of a sudden, hey, we're tag teaming Sunday night, and I get the title. I was like, okay, that's not really a title, but God, what are you saying to the churches? Yeah. That's pretty simple. You know, if you're hearing from God, you should already know what to say. Yeah. So going home that night, and on into the morning, I'm praying, God, what is it are you wanting to say? Yeah. And I felt kind of bad because this is how God said it. He said, son, I've been telling you the whole week. And I'm like, okay, true. I didn't think nothing about it. But you just always want to make sure you're in the timely word of God and obeying what he's wanting to say. But the whole point, and it brought me to Paul, one of the ones who simply wrote quite a bit of letters to the churches. Amen? Yep. And during this time, you got to remember, Paul is one of the guys who killed all our guys. He killed all the Christians, everything. Like, he was a bad dude. We've called him again. Let's say, if we had the better way of trying to describe who he was an Adolf Hitler of our time. Yeah. He killed tons of people. But here he is on the road to Damascus in Acts 9, and now he is blinded. He has stopped. God stopped him right where he was at and gave him blindness. Blinded him. And he literally said, and I love this, he says, who art thou, Lord? Yeah. This is Paul. He's far from God. And the first thing he can say is, who art thou, Lord?
Who art? Yeah.
There's nobody there. The men, they even said they saw no man. Nobody was there. And the voice said, I am Jesus, the one whom you persecute. Amen. But I love this. As he gets his blindness, he asks him, God, what is it you want me to do? When here he is stopped, and now he is experiencing the Lord God for the first time. He is now in uttermost blindness. The world doesn't matter to him. Nothing's going on except, who are you, Lord? That is his focus. God, who are you? And the very next question, he had two questions. Who are you, Lord? And what is it you want me to do?
Yeah.
That was the only two questions he had. And here's what God said. God told him and said, go into the city, and that is where you'll be told what to do.
Yeah. That's right.
Now, Paul could have sat there and lived the rest of his life. That could have been the end of Paul. Or that would have still been the beginning of Saul. He could have lived the rest of his life in blindness.
Yep.
And sadly, so many of us, we are still living in blindness.
Yeah,
God has stopped us in our tracks where we are at. He has sat there and shown himself to us. And we're like, God, I need a Savior. I am in need of a Savior. Who are you, Lord?
Who are you?
But we don't want to ask the question, God, what is it you want me to do?
Yeah.
God, what do you want me to do? We don't want to ask God that.
Yeah.
We're sitting there like, I believe. I believe in you, Jesus. And so many of us, we are those saints walking around right now blind. We are living out our days blind because we are not obeying the words of the Lord. Where the word of the Lord said, go. This is to Paul. Sat there and told him, go into the city, and that's where you'll be told what to do.
Right.
Same way when we come to God's house, we're coming so we can be told what to do. But in general, we're trying to find something. God, what is it you want me to do?
Yeah.
God, I want to do something. I want to work for you. I want to do something in the ministry that you're calling us to do. What is it you want me to do?
Right.
We don't want to ask God this question.
Yeah.
And it's all simply derived from obedience.
Yeah.
He was without sight for 3 days. He had a journey. And I believe in this journey, this is where Saul is now fellowshipping with Jesus.
Yeah.
He is now looking at things completely different. He can't see nothing but exactly what just happened. Everything I knew and what I was doing was a lie.
Yeah.
But something was changing in him. And God told him, go. And what did he do?
Yeah.
He went.
He went.
Some of us, we want things so easy. Naaman wanted it easy. Yeah. God, just send a prophet, send somebody to tell me something in my life so I can sit there and live the rest of life how I want to and everything. Just heal me in what I got going on. I got some financial situation. Something's bad going on in my life. God, I need a prophet, somebody just to fix it right now.
Yeah.
And he got mad because a man, the prophet told him, said, here, go and tell him to go wash yourself 7 times in the river and you'll be clean.
Amen.
He got mad.
Sure.
You mean to tell me the man of God himself can't come out and talk to me and lay hands on me and speak a word over me or something like that? He can't do it himself? And he was mad. He wasn't going to do it, but he simply said, you know what? The other guys started telling him, you surely didn't travel all this way to not at least do what the man of God said. He went out into the river. He dunked himself 1 time. Nothing changed. He dunked himself two times, nothing changed. He dunked himself three times, nothing changed. He kept dunking himself, and he could have stopped at five. Nothing was changing. But it's the fact that the man of God said, dunk yourself seven times. It's the simple obedience in the word of God and what he commands of us just to simply do something. Like sometimes it's literally like us. We go around and we live in life and doing the same old stuff every day. All of us are guilty of it. We just go out, do church. We literally do church and just play the roles and whatever what it is and just keeping our seats warm and everything else. But we don't want to sit there and ask God, what is it you want me to do? What can I do for you, God?
Yeah.
I want to read right here in 2 Corinthians 10. Listen to this. Verse 3. For though we walk in flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God's to the pulling down of strongholds.
Yeah.
Casting down, this is verse 5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing in captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ.
Yeah.
Casting away all these imaginations, everything that goes strictly against the knowledge of God. The word of God is knowledge.
Yeah.
It is wisdom. Yeah. It is understanding. Yeah. It is all this. But you know what most important it is? It is a person.
Amen.
This word that we read is just not some book. This is a person. This is Jesus Christ himself. Yeah. Amen. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, John 1:1. We got to understand this is a person that we're reading. No wonder you understand and start to gain so much when you dig into it, because there's so much more to him. I'm sitting there praying. I'm asking God, God, I want more. Show me more that I can do. There's so much more. There's always more to you, so there's more I can do. And the one thing he's been telling me all week is he says, my people do not have a vision.
Yeah.
They do not have a purpose. They have nothing. You know how you know? You know how you don't have a vision or a purpose? It's because you don't do nothing. We don't do nothing. We come to church, but we don't do nothing. There is no work in my faith. James 2:20 says, faith without works is dead. But it goes on and says, I will show you my faith by my works.
That's right. Yeah.
You're going to see my faith in my Jesus Christ by the work I do here. Like I said, we are blinded. We're like Paul. We're at that stage. God, we're saved, but we're blind.
Yeah.
Because we're not obeying your words.
Yeah.
Walking. We're here in church. Church is over. We're walking. There's a full trash can. Blinded.
Yeah.
There's something to do. You could take the trash out.
Yeah.
There's a piece of trash in the yard. Blinded.
Come on.
The simple things. Wash yourself seven times in the river. Simple things. But it's not how we want it. But man, we sure want God to do something in our lives every time. But what about us? Why are we not asking the question, God, what is it you want me to do? The very next scripture, verse 6, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled.
Amen.
Man. Having a readiness to revenge all disobedience.
Yeah.
But when can I do this? When can I have a readiness to revenge all disobedience? It says, when your obedience is fulfilled.
Yeah.
It all started, all this started in the garden. Adam and Eve, disobedient.
Yeah.
He said, you can have of every tree in this garden, but this tree do not touch. Even when the serpent comes along, did God really say you'll die and everything? It doesn't matter what comes along. No matter what such and such says, well, it'll be good for you to do this. It doesn't matter what this person says or even what another preacher says. It's what God says.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
There's plenty out there that prophesy all the time, seeking, again, that hand. God, just do something in my life right now. I don't want to live for you. I don't want to do nothing for you, but just do something for me. We don't have a vision to work. We don't have a vision, much less for this church.
Come on.
We come to church, but we don't have a vision for the church.
Come on.
We are so close, church, to paying this church off. There's so much more we can do outside of these four walls, but it's got to start here. We have no vision as far as what we want to do outside of these walls. Same way when somebody walks in, we're blind.
Yeah.
We only got a handful that actually go to somebody and say, glad to see you this morning. Glad to see you tonight.
Yeah.
So glad you're here with us.
Amen.
Just simple things. We have no vision. And the reason we know we don't have a vision, it all connects back to the very first thing I said. God is faithful to whom we are all called to the fellowship of our Lord, Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We don't have a vision because we don't have a fellowship. We don't have a relationship with Jesus.
Come on.
You don't have to sit there and tell me you ain't talking to him. I can see it in your walk.
Yeah.
We can see each other how close we are to God, because when we're close to God and we're walking like how we are to, we're asking God every day, God, what is it you want me to do? Who are you, Lord?
Yeah.
What is it you want me to do?
Amen.
What is it you want me to do today? Starts by simply seeking after him, but then it's like, God, what can I do?
Yeah.
Give me a vision to work.
Yeah.
Give me a vision to sit there and see this church grow. We want to see each other grow, but it starts in our faith.
Uh-huh.
It starts there.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm going to keep reading. Listen, this is Romans 1, right off the beginning. It says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. You know, it was Saul, a killer of Jews,
yep.
A killer of Christians. But now we read and it says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. We've seen where Pastor, that's what it means to simply give yourself to God.
Yeah.
Giving your life to him is you are now a server.
Yep.
It didn't say Paul, a mighty man of God. It said a servant of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
From that day forward, when he was blinded, God, you are real.
Yeah.
I'm in need of a Savior.
Yeah.
What is it you want me to do? I'm a servant of you.
Yep.
I'm here to serve you. This life that I think is huge is so much more bigger than what I can see in the here and now.
Yeah.
There's so much more. Listen, it says called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God.
Yeah.
Separated.
Separate.
Separated from this world. Separated from the things of everything that he even desired. Separated unto the gospel of God. What's the gospel? His word.
Amen.
Amen. Which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. But listen to this, verse 5. By whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. Obedience to the faith.
Amen.
It's just that simple. It's when we come to God, it's now obedience to the faith. I don't just have faith. I have faith who is a person, is Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen. Hebrews 12:2, look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Amen.
Yeah.
He is our faith.
Amen.
So when it says obedience to the faith, it's obedience to the gospel, obedience to the word of God, obedience to him.
Yeah.
Obedience to the faith. I'm not just trying to sit there and talk about the faith. I'm not just sitting there trying to come and hear about this faith.
Amen.
I'm coming to obey the faith.
Obey.
I'm coming to obey the word of God. Amen?
That's right.
We'll read again. Listen to this. This is Ephesians 4 right here. I love this. He gave some apostles. This is verse 11. Ephesians 4, he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ.
Yeah. Amen.
Why did he give us these preachers and teachers and the ones that come to give us this word? Why? It's for the perfecting of us.
Yeah. Right.
We're here to be perfect. Jesus even said, go and be perfect just as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. None of us are perfect, but he didn't say we aren't to strive for perfection.
Amen.
I can't stand and say, well, I'm not perfect. You're giving yourself an excuse to quit.
Yeah.
You're giving yourself an excuse to not do something.
Right.
Well, nobody's perfect. Why can't you be? Why can't you be when the very one whom died for you is perfect? And he's the very one that says, go and be perfect,
yeah,
just as your Father which is in heaven is perfect.
Amen.
There was a change in Saul from that day forward when he was blinded, because now he's not only, God, I'm in need of a Savior, but God, what is it you want me to do? I want to be a servant of you. I'm here to live for you and do whatever it is that it takes to simply do your work. That was his mindset. That was his goal. But it says, and again, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. We are the body of Christ.
Amen.
We are not to neglect the assembling of ourselves together.
Right.
That's what we come here for. God has even showed me just in the last few weeks how important it is for each other here. We get in the purposes like, I got Jesus. Some of us, we try to have a relationship with Jesus, but then we don't want to have a relationship with the rest of the body of Christ. And that's where we've neglected. That's where we messed up. God didn't just give us him to fellowship with, but he's given us each other.
Amen.
We are a body here to work and fight together, just like in the drama. Each one had their own buddy.
Yeah.
Y'all, we are in a buddy system here.
Yeah.
By gosh, find you a buddy, touch hands, everything, and tell each other, I got your back.
Yeah. Come on, buddy.
We know God's got our back, but the whole reason is he died for that fellowship, but he died for us all. And when we come in here, we're in the army.
Amen.
We are the soldiers in this army working together, but we have no vision.
Right.
We're all walking blind.
Come on, preacher.
We literally look like church's chicken. Look like a bunch of chickens with our heads cut off, just walking around. No sense of direction. Just all over the place. Just doing our own thing.
Come on. Yeah.
But it's time we actually get our vision back. And how do we get our vision back? We simply obey God's word. Sometimes God's blessings in our life is derived just from how our obedience is.
Yeah.
We have to simply obey sometimes what he says. We sit there and think, if I come to church, if I give my tithes, if I sit there and do this, God, I can pay you off. I can sit there and you can bless me and do whatever. But all he wants is your obedience. Yes, you should pay your tithes. Yes, you should come to church.
Yeah.
But simply your obedience sometimes can unlock the door of so much more blessings that God even wants to pour out onto you.
Yeah.
Have any of y'all realized how much God's wanting to bless you, but he's having to hold back because you're holding back from your obedience unto his word? God is still waiting on some of us in our obedience just to simply do something. Some of us literally ain't doing nothing. We come to church. We hear. That's all we do. We hear. Man, that was a good message. And we don't do nothing with it.
Come on.
We go out into the world, we work, we do our own thing, we get sidetracked, we get aggravated at the little stuff.
Yeah.
We want God to give us grace, but we can't give old such and such to just cut us off in front of the road grace.
Yeah.
God, give me grace, but I sure can't show it.
Come on, preacher. Yeah.
We have to have a vision to work. A vision to work. Do y'all want to see this church grow? Do y'all want to see things happen? Just simple events that we have here at the church. Where are the help? Where is the church? We have sometimes visitors that come and say, man, well, we just seen you on your own online and everything. Or somebody gets invited by somebody else. They come and visit. And the person that says they come here ain't even here.
Amen.
We have no vision. We have no relationship with Jesus.
Amen.
All he's asking is just simple obedience. He even says in the Word of God that obedience is better than sacrifice.
Amen.
Some of us, we sacrifice an hour to 2 hours, whatever we can give him on Thursday night, Sunday morning. God, I'll sacrifice a little bit of my time, but I don't want to obey your word.
Come on. That's right.
He wants your obedience more than he does sacrifice.
Yes, he does.
Just think of what God can do with each and every one of us in obedience, but also working together.
Amen.
We're here together. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I'll be in the midst. Jesus is here right now.
Amen.
He's talking to us right now.
Yes, he is.
He's wanting us to grow right now.
Come on.
But there's so much more. There's a vision through each and every one of us, through ourselves, that God wants to do. But there's a vision for this church.
Yeah.
There is a vision for every church out there. If he could just get the body of Christ to just simply do this one word, obey.
Obey.
If he could just get so many, I'm saved, walking around blind. We have blind Christians. They don't care. God, you saved me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Come on. Yep.
Thank you for what you did. And then here he goes, pastor singing that song. Just, man, it's just a little.
Yep.
Me giving my life compared to what he done for us.
Hallelujah.
Me just giving up this world, just the little things. It's still nothing compared to the sacrifice he gave.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
How many of us right now would say we would stand in the way and die for somebody else?
Come on.
Who's to say if somebody was in that situation where if you could be the one to save their life, would you save their life?
Yeah.
That's a hard thing to do. But he stood in the way. And I love this about the Word of God. And it sits there and said that he opened his mouth not.
Right.
Throughout everything he went through, the beatings, the simple poking, the thorns on the head, everything he had, being nailed to the cross, he never opened his mouth.
Thank you, Lord.
Because he had each and every one of us on his mind. He himself had a vision.
Right. Yeah.
Jesus had a goal, and nothing was going to take him away from that goal. Even when Satan himself tried to throw him off, say, you don't have to do this.
Yeah.
Just like we did with Adam and Eve. You don't have to do this.
Yeah.
Jesus spoke back and threw the very one thing I'm trying to get us to obey.
Yeah.
He threw the word at him. He says, for it is written. The very thing that when the enemy comes, and it's awesome. Me and Brandon, I'm going to tell this as many times as I can. We're sitting there golfing, and we're done. We're leaving, and there's two little kids over here selling some lemonade. You want to buy some lemonade? I said, shoot, yeah. Give me some lemonade. I'm hot. So we got us some lemonade, and I'm not kidding y'all. We drive around the corner, park the cart. We're sipping on our lemonade, and then somebody comes around this corner. And says, hey guys, these was left on the cart and they're still ice cold. It was two. One for me, one from Brandon. Two Coors Light.
Yeah.
Some beer.
Yeah.
Here, y'all can have them. No, thank you. Said, I would just sit there and pour them things out. I said, I even told Brandon, I said, I'll take my lemonade over demonade. Amen. I said, I'm just going to pour it out. And sure enough, he throws it right in the trash can. I said, that's a good place for him.
Yeah.
But ain't that crazy how simply, just even in the good things that we think are happening in our life, how the enemy, and I'm not calling the poor fella, just come around, he thought he was doing something cool and good to just some other guys and everything. But ain't it amazing, the timing-wise, it's like now he comes around,
yeah.
Here's some beer.
Yeah.
It's a little better, and it's ice cold, still out the cooler.
Yeah.
It'll give you a little high. No, I got the most high, Jesus, amen?
Yeah. Yeah.
But right there, and that boy, and they, y'all didn't hear Daddy, they said, well, they got Coors Light, we got Christ Light. new drink coming soon. It's just going to be juice. And on the back of the can, do this in remembrance of me. But in reality, I'm closing, so tag, get ready. But in reality, this is exactly how our walk is. It is tough, but it's a battle. Again, it's a fight. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness, principalities, and the darkness of this world.
Right.
But there's so much more than what meets our eyes. And just in just how that just blew my mind. I'm like, ain't that crazy how you go from something so quick and then boom. Temptation right around the corner. You go from one corner, man, I'm in the highest I can be, feeling good now. And then boom, you come around the other corner, temptation comes.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Temptation. We got to have a vision again.
Yeah.
It's time we obey God's word so that we can have our eyes completely opened up to the understanding and wisdom that is in this word. Amen.
Amen.
There's so much we're going to do. There's so much we can do. But the question is, and I like saying this on, look, Miss Janice, if you don't do your part, Lamon, you don't pitch in your part, and if I don't pitch in my part, we won't have a part to pitch in.
What a good thing.
It's as simple as that. Yeah. You gotta step up to the plate and get ready to hit something. We got plenty of cheers now, but we got nobody on the battlefield, okay? Just letting y'all know, we got everybody to sideline. Woo!
Cheers.
And we're the same one saying, well, Pastor's right here, but where's the rest of the team? We out here, we'll give Pastor pats on the back. Pastor, you're doing a great job. Where's the rest of the team? What are we doing? Somebody else, we could cheer Pastor on. God, Pastor, you keep doing those battles. You keep praying for us and taking care of us. I'm going to go out here and play another round of golf. You keep fighting those spiritual battles. We throw it all on him, but we are in this together. We are the church. We are the body of Christ. But it starts with having our eyes opened again to the vision of God's word and just simply obeying it. walk in the very call that he has given us, and that's simply seek him and just obey him in his word and just do it. I'm going to end with that. Mary said it best. Nike never said it first. Mary said, whatever he asks of you to do, there's a lot of commandments in here. Whatever he asks of you to do, just do it in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus, tonight. Lord, you're worthy tonight. My Lord, it's high time to wake up out of sleep because your redemption is nearer than when you first believed. Romans 13, verses 15 tonight. My Lord, if we really believed it, we'd say hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, tonight. My Lord Jesus, when I thought about what the Spirit of the Lord was saying unto the churches, my mind went all the way to Revelation 3, verses 15 and verses 16. He said, I know your word. He says, you're neither hot and you're not cold, but because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. My Lord, we got lukewarm Christianity that thinks we can serve Jehovah on Sunday, but during the week we're going to serve Baal. My Lord, it says in 1 Kings 18, verses 21, Elijah told the people, how long are you going to halt between two opinions? If Baal be God, then follow him. But if the Lord be God, then follow him. My Lord Jesus, we got a lot of people halting. The reason they're giving up, the reason they're throwing in the towel is because they're so lukewarm. They say, Jesus, I love you. I thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross. But let me go sleep with somebody I ain't married to. Let me go drink. Let me go cuss. My Lord, the Lord sent a crazy prophet named Elijah that had enough of guts to stand up before the people and say, how long? That's what I've come to not to say. How long are we going to be double-minded? How long is the church going to have two standards? How long are we going to tolerate sin in the pulpit? How long are we going to tolerate sin being in the altars? How long are we going to keep sin in our life? My Lord, if you're going to serve him, then serve him 100%. If not, then go follow Baal. But my God requires you to choose who you're going to follow. My Lord, God sent a crazy prophet named Elijah to rebuild the altar. My Lord, America, not only the church, America, with the church, if we're going to see revival again, we got to be like Elijah. We got to rebuild the altar again. It said the altar was broken down, and God sent a crazy prophet, Elijah. It said, son, go rebuild my altar. My Lord, and that's when he rebuilt the altar and he put the sacrifice of bullock, and it said the water came running down from the altar. My Lord, and it said they were crying aloud. The 450 prophets of Baal, they were crying aloud. And Elijah was mocking Baal. He said, has your God taken a vacation? Last time I checked, my God hasn't taken vacation. My Lord, last time I checked, he rose from the dead over 2,000 years ago on a Roman rugged cross. So I didn't have to live in sin. I didn't have to live, my Lord, like the world, but I can get up out of sin, Sister Janice. My Lord Jesus, we got victory in Jesus, but we got to learn to stop halting. We got to learn to rebuild the altar again. And he said to the 450 prophets of Baal, because they started cutting themselves. They started cutting themselves before their unknown God, and they were crying aloud, crying aloud. And the fire never came. Don't you know our God is as a consuming fire? Hebrews 12 verses 29. My Lord Jesus, he wants to consume all. He wants your whole heart tonight. He wants everything. He don't want 99%. He wants 100%. My Lord, tonight. And it says in verses 37, and Elijah cried out, "Oh Lord, hear my cry, so these people's hearts may be turned back unto you." And it said the fire of God fell and burned up the wood, the bullock. And it said he licked up the water. My Lord, tonight, if we're going to follow God, we're going to have to let him consume us again. The church is going to have to let him consume us. We won't revive or fire, but until we learn to rebuild the altar, and until we learn to say, "God, I'm living as a sacrifice before you, God. I'm tired of halting between two opinions, God. I want to know you just like Moses did, as a man would his best friend." Exodus 33 verses 11, and in verses 41 of 1 Kings 18, it says, Elijah said, "I hear the abundance of rain." My Lord Jesus, if we want the revival fire for the rain to come, we first must get back to rebuilding his altars, preachers. We got to get back to his being saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Because last time I checked, when I wasn't saved, I didn't want to go to church. Last time I checked, when I wasn't saved, I didn't want to do what was right. We got people walking around slothful. You know why they slothful? Because they're halting between two opinions. You're lukewarm. My Lord, just like Eutychus. In Acts 20 verses 9, Paul was long preaching. Thank God for long-winded preachers. My Lord, he was up there on the windowsill in Acts 20 verses 9. My Lord Jesus, as Paul was long preaching, I can see it in the theater of my mind. He's got one foot on one side of the world, and he's got one foot in the church. And it said he fell out from the windowsill, and he was taken up dead. It's time for the church to stop straddling the fence. If you won't serve God, you got to get in or get out of the way. My Lord Jesus, tonight, my Lord Jesus, it says the way, the desire of a slothful man killeth him, because he refuses to do labor. My Lord, in Proverbs 21 verses 25, a slothful man, it kills him, Sister Janice, because he has no labor with his hands. My Lord, a slothful man reminds me of somebody who's wasting away, who's halted along the way. You may be like the children of Israel. You may have halted between two opinions. But my God, don't you know God can take what's dead and make it live again? Just like he did in Ezekiel 37. He said, God, the Lord asking him a question. He said, "Can these bones live?" And Ezekiel said unto him, he said, "God, only thou knowest." And he said, "Prophesy from the four winds of heaven." And he said, "Hear ye the word of the Lord." My Lord Jesus, we need ears to hear again. My Lord God, give us ears to hear your word. But not be ye just hearers only, but be ye doers of the word. James 1 verses 22. We need some doers that can be like Elijah and say, "God, I'm standing up for truth." Because we stand by faith. 2 Corinthians 1 verses 24. A slothful man. Slothfulness says, "I can sleep in on Sunday." Slothfulness says, "I don't need to pray today." It didn't say he couldn't do it. He said he refused to do it. Many are called, but few are ever chosen. Matthew 22 verses 14. You know the difference between somebody who's saved and who's actually a follower of Jesus. They get up even when they don't feel like getting up, and they do what God's called them to do. My God, if everybody sat around and started feeling sorry for themselves like Elijah did in 1 Kings 19, we would all be left out. The disciples would have never preached and wrote down the gospel. My Lord, it ain't that you can fall down. The fall doesn't define you. It's getting up again, because a righteous man may fall 7 times, but he arises up again. But the wicked shall fall into mischief. Proverbs 24 verses 16. It's time for the church to get up again. It's time for us to get up when we don't feel like it. It's time to get back up. And he says, wherefore I put you in remembrance, that you stir up the gift of God which is in you by the putting on of my hands. 2 Timothy 1 verses 6. I'm putting you in remembrance this night. You're going to either stir it up or you're going to let it waste away. My God, you're going to have to get up and do what God's called you to do. My Lord, you can't be waiting on somebody else to do it. No, Jesus has called you to do it. If he's called you to preach, then preacher, preach. My God, if he's called you to sing, then sing. If it's called you to open up the door on Sunday morning, then open up the door. David said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. My Lord Jesus, we got so many people sitting down. You say, it says, the enemy, Daniel prophesied in Daniel 7 verses 25. It says the enemy's going to wear out the saints. That's right. You know why he's wearing us out? Because we're running from God's word. We're doing contrary to what God's word says. Jeremiah 20 verses 9, yeah, I couldn't help myself. That word was in my heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones. I became weary with forbearing, and I could not stay. My Lord Jesus, the word made him move again. The word can make you move again if you'll move it. He's went as far as the cross. As I was thinking about the cross today and all that he endured, Sister Janice, I didn't feel like getting up here, but I remembered his cross. My Lord, tonight, if we'll consider his cross and what he did for us, we'll get up. We won't sit back. We won't shut up. We're going to cry loud. My God, my Lord Jesus, tonight, we got to stop halting. The church has halted for too long. That's why when the preacher preaches, they said, oh, and it said that they couldn't even answer him a word. But even that's speaking for itself. We can shout over a miracle. We can shout over a blessing. But until you learn to shout over his cross, you shout shallow. I'm talking about something that goes so deep. I'm going to leave you with Exodus 3, verses 5. The Lord told Moses, because he appeared in a burning bush. He said, Moses, if you're going to come any closer, you're going to have to take off your shoes. Because where you're standing is holy ground. That's what some of us need to do tonight. We need to step out of the sin. We need to let it go. Sister Janice, if we're going to endure to the end, we can't have all the sin holding us back anymore. If we're going to, it says, he that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved. We can't endure with this heaviness on us. We can't endure with all the worldliness on us. My Lord, if we're going to come any closer, you're going to have to step out of what you're used to. Step out of it. It's time for the church to step out of the sin. Behold, hear my word. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be ye zealous, therefore repent, saith the Lord. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open up the door, I will come and sup with him and he with me. You know that's Revelation 3 verses 20. And you know verses 22. He that hath an ear, hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying unto the churches. He's saying, let me back in. Let me back in the service again. Let me back in your heart again. You remember when you first got saved? You couldn't help but get up in the morning and pray. And you said, God, all I want is you. God, you can have the whole world, but don't take you away from me. He's knocking at somebody's heart tonight. It's time to come out with your hands up and say, God, I surrender. I'm tired of playing games like the soldiers did at the foot of the cross, playing games at his foot of his cross. My Lord, it's time to make up your mind. Who you gonna follow? Are you gonna follow the devil? Are you going to follow the world? Are you going to follow Jesus? Hear ye this day. He says, how long are you going to choose your sin over me? He loved us so much that he took it in his body, that we be dead unto sin, shall live in his righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed. Somebody will get healed tonight if you give him all. Somebody tonight needs to forgive somebody. You say, God, I want to be healed. Well, you got to learn to forgive somebody. My Lord, tonight, we got to learn to open up again. You provide the fire. I'll provide the sacrifice. You provide the Spirit, Holy Ghost. Some of us, if we'll be transparent tonight, you'll say, preacher, I've been just playing games with God. I've been putting on a face for everybody else. But in reality, when I go home, I start dabbling here and dabbling there. But tonight I want to be 100%. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Romans 10 verses 13. My Lord, he's went as far as the cross. It's time for you to make up your mind. Lord, you separate the godly for yourself. Tonight, God, I pray you separate her. Lord, give her boldness to stand up for the truth. Thank you, Holy Ghost, tonight. Lord, use our young people tonight, Lord. Where could I stand? How could I leave the shelter? Somebody tonight, you came in here feeling like you don't want to live. But God says, if you'll come to my altar tonight, I'll deliver you from that. you shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. Psalms 118 verses 17. Come on, church. My Lord, somebody shouldn't have to beg you to come to the altar. If you're saved, you should want to come to the altar. It's time to rebuild, repair the altar. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Move us, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Where can I go? Thank you, Jesus. Lord God, I pray we give you 100% tonight, Lord Jesus. Lord, I thank you, Holy Ghost, right now. Because your mercy goes much deeper. Lord, I pray you touch each and every one of us tonight, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Lord, I pray we rebuild the altar again in our life, God, that we have a prayer life again. Thank you, Holy Ghost, tonight. Your mercy. He ain't forgot about you, Sister Melissa. What I start, I finished. Oh, woman, be made whole. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Sister James, don't you know what he starts? He finishes it. I be of good cheer, my child. Thank you, Holy Ghost, tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Lord, I thank you, Jim. And I go. You may not feel like a mighty man of God, just like Gideon. And Judges 6 verses 1, as he was hiding from the Midianites. But God says to you tonight, my mighty man of valor, Herobosata, you are mine, saith the Holy Ghost. Herobosata, Herobosai, thank you, Jesus. When I'm going under, I reach for you, Jesus. Holy Ghost says, reach for me, Ashley. Seek me early, and ye shall find me when you search for me with all thine heart. When you find me, my child, what you need will follow. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Where could I go? Lord, separate her, God. Use her for your glory. The shelter. You touch her body. Woman, thou art healed from thine infirmity. God, I pray this infirmity be quenched, because God, you took it in your body that we didn't have to keep it no more. Lord, I pray she was healed at the heel tonight. Thank you, Holy Ghost, right now. Thank you, Jesus. Relationship is what's most important. Everything else ceases to exist. Lord, I thank you, Jesus, tonight. You stay in these altars. Lord, Thank you, Jesus. God, you be the glory. Thank you, Jesus.
Ain't you glad you came tonight? Amen. I believe God's opening some ears in the house tonight. Amen. That's what he's speaking for to do. He said, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. In Revelation 3, verses 22, you know, it's just as I asked the Spirit of God, you know, what you want me to speak. And as I was reading that scripture the other night, and that's exactly what he said. He said, what have I give each and every one of you? He said, I've given you ears. He said, he that hath an ear, each and every one of us, we got two ears. Don't you know God died for each and every one of us so he could speak to us? Amen. He said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. In John 15 and 13, don't you know each and every one of us, he gave his life so that we could have an intimate relationship and we could hear his voice and he could speak to us. Amen. He said in John 10 verses 27, he said, my sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. You got to be his sheep to be able to hear his voice. Amen. And to be able to hear his voice, you got to be walking close with him. Amen. I feel that's what he's doing tonight. He's drawing us back to that closer walk with him. Amen. He wants his church to walk close with him. Ain't that what we're all supposed to be? We're supposed to be sheep. Amen. We're the sheep of his house. Amen. If he's calling us to his house, to his assembly, therefore we're to be his sheep. You know, he had to go spend time with the Father. Amen. So if therefore Jesus had to spend time with the Father, don't you know that means we in too, we got to spend time with the Father. Amen. And we got to have that relationship with him to where we can hear him. Amen. And the way to hear him is through his word, and it's in the Spirit because he speaks through his word. Amen. He says to seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read, according to Isaiah 34 and 16. Oftentimes we can't discern what God's speaking because we don't know his word. Amen. That's why it's so easy. Why we get tossed to and fro whenever. That's why oftentimes you see the church world now, they want to hear the soothsayer. They want to hear something that feels good, something that they, you know, that appeases to the ears, because they don't know what God's word really says. Amen. But when you look at God's word, see, it'll pierce you coming in, but it'll heal you when it comes out. Amen. Because it said that his word is sharp, is powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder, soul and spirit, and the joint of the marrow, and discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart, according to Hebrews 4 and verses 12. It's his word. It may hurt you going in, but my God, it'll heal you when it comes out. Amen. And that's his word, and that's what often the church is missing and don't realize that they're missing his word. Amen. God wants to open his ears, but he wants us to have a desire to hear what his word says. Amen. Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 15 and 16, he said, I found thy words and I did eat them, and they were the joy and rejoicing of my soul, for I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. Amen. We're each and every one called by his name. Amen. We didn't choose him. He chose us. Amen. According to John 15 and 16, he chose us. He called us first, but it's up to us to choose his word. Amen. And to rejoice over his word. Jeremiah said it was the joy and rejoicing of my soul. That's what we got to do. We got to joy and rejoice over his soul because it's his word that he wants to speak to us. But we got to be open to receive his word. Amen. And that starts by knowing his word, being able to discern his word, and then therefore being in the spirit to be able to hear his word. Amen. Because the ultimate message above all, as you've heard pastor preach, Jesus is coming. That's the message he's speaking to the church. Regardless, no matter what, he's speaking that he is coming. Amen. And in order to hear that trumpet sound, you got to be in the spirit. That's why John said in Revelation 1 and 10, he said, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. Amen. He was in the spirit. That's how he could hear God speaking as a trumpet. And you read on in Revelation Revelation 4 and 1, he heard a voice as of a trumpet again saying, come up hither, amen. If you're going to hear that trumpet sound, if you're going to hear him call us home, when that day comes, you got to be walking in the Spirit, fellowshipping with him, coming after him each and every day with an open ear to hear his word, amen. That's how you're going to hear his coming, because it's at the door. It's imminent, amen. You find Luke, and you find a man named Simeon in Luke 2, verses 27. He said that, it said that Simeon was led by the Spirit to the house of God. You see that word Simeon in the Greek. His name means a hearer, amen. He was in the Spirit, therefore he heard God. And where did the God lead him when he heard him in the Spirit? He led him to the house. That's how you know many ain't walking in the Spirit, because they ain't coming to his house, amen. Because he said in Hebrews 10, verses 25, he said, forsaking not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another the much more as you see that day approaching. That day approaching is his coming, amen. And his coming is at the door. And as the closer we get to it, the more we should be coming to his house. The more we should be coming to fellowship with him, to come and to spend time in his altars, to come and hear his word preached. So then, therefore, when we hear his word preached, then we can take his word and we can go and declare it into a lost and dying world. Amen. And that's why it says it starts with obedience, as Pastor Dillan was saying. We come to his house. That's the first step in obedience. But then we have to take heed to his word. Amen. James 1 verses 22 says, being not just hearers of the word, but doers also, lest ye deceive yourself. We got a lot of deceived people nowadays, because they'll hear his word, but then they don't take and do it. Amen. They don't apply it to their walk. They don't apply it to their life, because it says that faith without works is dead, according to James 2 verses 20. If you don't take and apply what God's speaking to your life, then therefore it's all void. You're deceiving yourself. You think you're living a life that really you're not. You're living lost. You're walking lost, and you're not in the Spirit. And then therefore, when that trumpet sounds, you're not going to hear him call. Amen. But it comes with an open ear. And you see here in Isaiah 50 verses 4, this is speaking Isaiah, he's speaking prophetically about the Messiah. He's speaking about Jesus, how he made it right here. And he says, morning by morning, he wakeneth mine ear to hear as the learned. Verse 5, the Lord God hath opened mine ear, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away back. This was speaking of Jesus here, and you read on in verse 7, he said, for the Lord God will help me. Don't you know, if you want God's help, you got to have that open ear to what he wants to say to each and every one of us. Amen. It's his word. David said, let your word help me, for I've chosen. He said, Lord, help me. He said, for I've chosen your precepts. Let your right hand help me, for I've chosen your precepts, according to Psalms 119 and verses 165. It's his word that'll help us, but we got to be open up to receive it. Amen. But it's up to you whether you're going to take and say, God, I'm open to your word. I want to hear your word. Amen. Many has closed their ear. Many in this hour, they'll come to the house, but when it comes time to hear God's word, it's just closed off. They've turned their ear. They've turned in rebellion. But God said, if you'll open your ear, if you'll have an ear that's open to me, then therefore you won't turn away. Amen. Because many is turning away. It said that the Spirit speaketh expressly in the latter times that some shall depart from the faith, giving heeding to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. If you turn your way ear here from God's truth, then therefore you'll believe a lie. Amen. If you replace God's word with anything else, you'll be seduced. You'll fall into the trap of the enemy in his last hours. And that's where the soothsayer comes into play, because it said, then the last days that many false prophets shall arise, and they shall deceive many, according to Matthew 24 and verses 11. See, there's many arising, and there's many falling away. And it says that God said that day can't come without there first be a great falling away, in 2 Thessalonians 3 and verses 2. Amen. We're in that falling away, but it's because people have closed their ear to what God's saying. Amen. And if you turn your ear, see, the thing about God is, you know, the way you hear God, God takes notice of what you hear and do by what he says. Amen. The way you hear God, it in hand goes with him. Amen. As well. Because he says, if you turneth your ear away from hearing my law, even your prayer shall become an abomination. See, that's the thing that many don't speak about in this hour. Many, that would offend many. It's a hard word, according to John 6. But see, if you take what God's teaching, what God's speaking, what he's telling you to do, just as Pastor Dillan was saying, you know, the work he's giving you to do, the obedience, as Prophetess Breanna said, coming to the altar, doing the early work, doing what God's called you to do. If you don't take heed when God's dealing dealing with you and being obedient with you, he's not going to hear what you got to say when you call on him. Amen. Imagine this, your prayer being compared to homosexuality and a lying spirit is what it would be. And that's what an abomination is. God calls it that in Leviticus 18 and 20. He said, if a man lies with another man in mankind, he said, it is an abomination. It's the same way when you call on God's name in prayer and you're saying, you're wanting God to do this, wanting God to do that. When you've turned away in rebellion to him, God's going to turn his ear from you. He's going to turn his back. He's going to be nowhere to be found because you've turned your back on him. Amen. But that's what many don't realize. That's why it's so important. You got to have that open ear, and somebody that's open is somebody that's going to take heed to something. Amen. If you're open, you receive something. So you would receive correction. You would receive reproof. You would receive it. You're open to receive it. When you're open to something, therefore, you're going to turn around and do what you're being taught to do. Amen. And that's what the open ear is about. Because Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 4 and 2, he said, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. He said, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. Because he said, there's going to come a time when he said they're going to heap to themselves teachers after their own flesh, having itchy ears. And it says they're going to be turned away from the truth, and they're going to be turned over to fables. They're going to believe fables because they're going to turn their ear from truth. They're going to hear what they want to hear. And that's the hour that we're in now, right here in these last days. People want to hear what they want to hear, but they don't want to hear what God's got to say. And they turn their ear, and they're being turned over unto fables, doctrines of demons. When you can sit there, and you know, it's funny, on my job, I get to see a lot of people's business. You know, I deliver to their houses and get to see what's their decorative arts and all that. And, you know, the other day I was delivering to a house, and they'll have, you know, Joshua 24 and 15, as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. They'll have different Bible verses all over their porch, but then they'll have a political platform on their in their driveway that supports somebody who supports these doctrines of demons. Amen. Because abortion or anything with homosexuality, it is a doctrine of demons. Amen. And that's what many's turned over to, because they've turned their ear to God, even though they proclaim to be a Christian, but yet when they turn their ear in that matter, it's therefore an abomination. You're going hand in hand with that. Amen. And David said in Psalm 66 and 18, he said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, he said, the Lord won't even hear me. David said that. I'm going to take David's word at it, because David was a man after God's own heart. If anybody had a walk with God, it was David. And he said, if I regard, that word regard is to take notice. That means that I know that I'm sinning willfully. And the Bible says in James 4 and 17, it said, he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. If you know to do good and you're not doing it, therefore you're regarding, you know iniquity's in your heart. And therefore, if you know iniquity's in your heart, then guess what? God don't hear you. He said, God's not going to hear you. He said in Isaiah 59 right here in verses 1 and 2, this is why it said it goes hand in hand, whether if you take heed to what God says, if he'll take heed to what you do. Because he says here, he said, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that he cannot save, neither his ear heavy that it cannot hear. That just means, you know, God can do all things. Amen. His hand ain't short and he can't help you. His ear's not heavy that he don't hear that he can go save those lost loved ones you got. Amen. But then Isaiah goes on in verse 2. He says, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. He said it personally. He said, you're God. That means you had a relationship with him. He was once yours. He was your God, but you've turned your ear to him. And he says, he's separated, and your sins have hid his face from you, and he will not hear. If you turn your ear, God turns his face. The same way that you turned your ear to him, God's going to do the same thing to you. He takes and he turns his face, and then the ears, they're covered. He no longer hears what you've got to say. Amen. The only way he'll ever hear you after that is when you call on, if you call on him in repentance and ask him back into your heart. Now, he's always open to hear that. He's longing for you to do that, because then that restores. Then you can go back into fellowship with him, because that's ultimately what he died for. But it's up to you whether you're going to open up. Amen. Are your ears, have your ears been open tonight? Because the Spirit's been speaking. He speaks expressly. He speaks to the point. Amen. It's a hard word sometimes when God speaks, but it's to the point. And that's how he's been speaking tonight, is expressly. Each and every one of us, but you got to open up. Amen. Are you open to him? Are you willing to do what he says? Amen. He said, if you be willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. But if you rebel, you will be devoured by the mouth of the Lord, for the word of the Lord has spoken. You'll be devoured. devoured by the sword. Many's willing, but then they got to take that next step in obedience. You can hear God, but then it's up to you whether you obey God. Amen. You can hear him. We all hear him. He's give us all two ears. He said, he that hath an ear. We all got two ears. Amen. But then it's once you hear it and how close you walk, whether you take heed after what he's told you to do. Amen. So be obedient. And many times in the us, you know, turning our prayer into an abomination, if we do that, as often as we've just turned our ear, we'll say, well, you know, I do this for God, I do that for God. But if we turned our ear in another part when it comes to his word and to his precepts, then it's still an abomination when we call on him in prayer. Amen. Because it says that obedience is sacrifice, and to hearken is better than the fat of rams. You can't make a sacrifice in the place of obedience. It'll never work. Amen. And God won't never take pleasure in it. Amen. But continue, just let God stir your ear, let him open your ear, because that's what he wants to do, because he wants all of us to hear what he's got to say in these last hours. And above all, he wants us to be ready to hear when that trumpet sounds. Amen. That's why it's important to be open to what he's got to say. Amen. So to Jesus be the glory.
Amen. Come on, give God praise. In God we praise his word, and the Lord we praise his word. Psalm 56 and 10. Quote this with me from Hebrews 3:7. Wherefore today, if you'll hear the voice of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost, when it concerns your walk with God, he never tells you to procrastinate. He never tells you to wait till the next service to give your life to Christ. He never says, go home, get things put in order, try to be a better person, and then come to Christ. No, the Holy Spirit is always saying now. 2 Corinthians 6:2 said, I've secured thee in an accepted time, and in the day of salvation I've secured thee. He said, behold, now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. Somebody say, the Spirit of God, which is the Spirit of Christ, always says, now's the time. He's always saying, today is the day. When should I surrender to the Lord? Somebody say, right now. Today. When should I serve God? Right now. Today. The enemy. That's right. Give God praise for that. That's the word of the Lord. That's so simple, but sometimes it's the simplicity of it that we complicate. Amen. The Holy Ghost is always saying, go pray now. He's not telling you, no, wait later. You can pray later. Procrastination is really just another revelation of slothfulness. Amen. Laziness, you know, putting it off to a better time. Somebody say, now is always the right time to call on the Lord. Now is always the right time. Amen. Praise God, to serve the Lord and put your faith in him. Amen. And come to the altar. If you're sitting in a service, amen, and your heart's a beating and this thought just keeps coming through your mind, you need to go to the altar and pray. You need to go to the altar and pray. Somebody say, that is not the devil. Hallelujah. You won't interrupt those that are in the spirit if you listen to the spirit. Come on, somebody, and hit the altars. Amen. Brianna come back in the sound booth. She said, I think I went beyond my 20 minutes. I said, who cares? I said, I was already setting Dillan up and the rest of them. I said, I knew the altar call was coming. God wanted to do something right then. And I said, we're not going to be stifling the Spirit of God. We're not going to, amen, tell the Holy Ghost, you know, you can come in here, but you have to get permission from us when you can do what you want. No, it's his house. It's his power. It's his kingdom, his glory, not ours. Amen. Matthew 6:13 declares that. So I said, no, you never went past your time when the Holy Ghost is starting to move. It don't matter after that what we had planned and had set up. Amen. The Holy Ghost can interrupt us, because if he can't interrupt us, he can't intervene for us. And divine intervention comes through divine interruption. So Holy Spirit, I just say anew, you can interrupt us anytime you want. When God says now, he means now. Somebody say, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think, according to his power which works in us, Ephesians 3:20. Somebody say, now unto him. If you'll give your life now unto him, he'll turn your now around, and it'll spell W-N. Turn, amen. One, that's how you'll be one. That's how you become the winner. Somebody say, from being a sinner to a winner. Now. Somebody, demons, and that's who they are, they telling you you're not good enough. Well, guess what? You'll never be good enough to come. to him, but it ain't about your goodness or mine. Our righteousness is as filthy rags, Isaiah 64:7. Somebody say, you can't never be good enough. You can't never do enough of good, amen, to be good enough to come to God. But thank God, Jesus, who did no sin, knew no sin, took our sins in his body on the tree, that we dead in sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed or converted, 1 Peter 2:24. We're never going to be good enough, but he says now. But Brother Marvin, you don't know what I've done. You don't know how I've failed. You don't know how I've made so many mistakes. Somebody say, you may make mistakes, but you're not a mistake. God created you, and you're his creation, but until you come to faith in him and follow him, somebody say, you can't be his child. Because we're children of God through faith in Jesus Christ, Galatians 3:26. And when it comes to the salvation of your soul and mine, when it comes to our redemption, our Redeemer is always saying, now's the time. Not only can tomorrow be too late, tonight could be too late. Before the sun sets could be too late. So back to Hebrews 3:7, wherefore today, if you hear the voice of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost always says when it concerns Jesus, and especially in light of eternity, now's the time. Somebody say, now is the time perfect. Amen. Praise God. Isaiah 50:5. This is messianic. That means this is a prophecy through Isaiah the prophet about Jesus. He said he opened his ear and he did not turn his back. But then it said in verse 6, he gave his back to the smiters and his cheeks to those that plucked out the hair. He hid not his face from the shame nor the spitting. Jesus said, Isaiah was saying what Christ said to the Father. I have opened my heart to you and I have not been rebellious. I've obeyed you. I didn't turn my back away, but I did give my back to a cross. Hallelujah. Amen. And he said, I gave my cheeks to those who plucked out the hair, hid not my face from the shame nor the spitting. And then he said in verses 7, and he talked about how the Lord helped him. In other words, enabled him to endure that cross. And it says his face was like a flint, his forehead like a flint. In other words, thank God Jesus had a hard head. He was hard-headed toward what the demons and what the religious system and political system of his day would have told him. But somebody say he resisted all that and he obeyed the Father. Come on, he resisted the religion of his time. He resisted the politics of his time. And he says, no, I'm going to the cross. Everything around him was saying, no, don't go to the cross. Don't go to the cross. But somebody say he gave his back. He didn't turn his back to God, but he gave his back. Hallelujah. And he faced the cross. He defied everything, glory to God, that would keep him from going to that cross. Why? Because he loved me and you just that much. Somebody say, Jesus loved us before we were ever created, knew him we'd be born in sin. But somebody say he loved us so much that he did not rebel against his Father. He obeyed his voice. He opened his ear and did what God told him to do. And somebody say he turned his back to the cross, but he did not turn his back to God. Somebody say, don't turn your back on God. Turn to the cross. Turn to the one who hang on the cross. Come on, somebody. Thank God he weren't disobedient or none of us would have been saved. It was through the disobedience of one man, Adam, that sin came on us all. But it was through the obedience of one man, somebody say Jesus, that all of us could be redeemed. Jesus had to obey the Father to purchase mine and your redemption. And the way we receive it is we just do like he does. Somebody say we obey him. We do what he tells us to do. Now look, I could care less. I've been in a business now called the Father's Business, amen, for almost 34 years, and I could care less what somebody thinks about me, whether they think it's too long or it's too loud or if it's too this or whatever. But I want y'all to play that song again, and when that song ends, we'll be through. But I'll leave 99 to go after one, and I've been preaching to one. I've been preaching to someone, and the Holy Ghost ain't just saying something to the church. He's saying to somebody, I want you to be part of my church. I want you to come into the fellowship of me, says the Lord. And he's saying, don't wait till tomorrow. Don't boast in tomorrow. You don't know what a day's going to bring, Proverbs 27:1. Somebody say, today, if you'll hear the voice of the Holy Ghost. Do you hear him? Boy, he's been talking loud and clear. He's saying, come, come, come. Now is the time. Yeah, come, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Hallelujah. Revelation 22:13. Somebody say the Holy Ghost. He's saying, come, come, come. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Matthew 11:28. Don't you hear him calling you to come? Your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, your mercy goes much deeper, much farther than I can see. Your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, much farther than I can see. I reach for you when I'm going under. I'll wait for you, Jesus, you're my lifeline. Where could I go? Where could I stay? The shelter of your hand. Where could I go? Where could I stay? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Don't leave, don't leave, says the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord, before you come to me, come. Don't you hear him calling, come? Hallelujah. Where could I go? Where could I stay? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Where could I go? Where could I stay? How could I leave the shelter of your hand, Lord? 'Cause your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace rescues me. 'Cause your mercy goes much deeper, much farther than I can see. Your sins may be many, but God said where sin abounds, my grace does that much more abound. Romans 5:20. Somebody say, God's got more grace than hell has sin. Thank God. Yeah, he can reach much farther than I can see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be ye zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear my voice and will open the door, I'll come in and sup with him and he with me. And who is it that will overcome? Because to him that overcometh, will I give to sit with me in my throne, just as I overcame and sat down in the throne with my Father. Let him that hath an ear hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. Revelation 3, verse 19 through 22. You can overcome, but you got to hear his voice knocking. His voice is saying, repent. Turn away from your sin and turn to me. If you open to me, I'll come into you and have have supper with you, and you and me will have fellowship. And when you do, you'll overcome this world, because he that's born of God is the one that overcomes the world. 1 John 5, verse 5. You'll become an overcomer. You'll no longer be overcome, but you'll be the one that overcomes. Oh, but you can't overcome until you come on over to this side. Somebody say, come to the Lord, and when you do, you can overcome. Do you hear him? Where could I go? Where could I stay? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Where could I go? Hallelujah. Lord, where could I stay? How could I leave? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Oh yeah, where could I go? I tell you, go to the altar, go to the cross, come to him and call on his name, and he'll cleanse you, he'll receive you, he'll change you. Yes. Oh, where could I go? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Lord, I speak your blood. I pray for all those, and even just the ones that need to call out to you at this moment. Because though the Spirit of God is saying many things to the churches, he's also speaking to those he's trying to bring into his church to be a part of his body. So, Lord, I thank you, God, you're speaking right now. I just pray somebody would open their ear and open their heart and not turn their back, just like you opened your ear, and how you didn't turn away your back but gave your back on the cross so we could be forgiven. You can't go home and get better, and you can't choose the time. We don't choose him, he chooses us. John 15:16. Somebody say, he's chosen this time. He's chosen now. He's done declared it. Now is the time. Today is the day. Come right now. If you don't want to come to this altar and you know you need to, ask somebody you came with or ask somebody around you, will you go and pray with me at that altar? We're not going to embarrass people and put a mic up under your lip, turn you around and make you face the crowd. All we're concerned about is if you get right with God and you know before you leave this church service tonight that you have come into the kingdom of God, that Christ becomes your Lord. Because we may none have another opportunity to ever come back in the house of God. Jesus could come or death could come. Hallelujah. So now's the time. Yeah, somebody needs to say yes to the Lord. Somebody needs to say yes. Come on, there's only one other alternative. It's no. Don't tell him no. Thank God he didn't say no when the Father said go die for him on the cross. He said for us yes. And all he wants you to do is just come and say yes, Lord. Yes. Come on, call on Jesus. Yes. If you believe Jesus was born of a virgin, if you believe God raised him from the dead after he was crucified for your sins, if you ask him to forgive you, he does it. He does it right then. You don't have to wait days. You don't have to join a local church, be baptized in water, though those are something you need to do. Those are some important things. But nothing saves you but Jesus. When you come to him and call on you, he saves you. Saves you from your sins, and he saves you from the judgment that's to come. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, they will be saved. Romans 10:13. If you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Hallelujah. Romans 10:9. Everybody pray, say, Jesus, I believe you were born of a virgin. I believe you took my sins in your body on the cross so my sins could be forgiven. I believe you were raised from the dead. And I ask you to forgive me tonight. I turn away from that and I turn to you. Lord, have mercy on me. I believe and I receive you as my Savior. Everybody say, in the name of the Lord Jesus. In the name, Lord Jesus, save me. Oh yeah, Bartimaeus just said, Son of David, have mercy on me. Come on, cry to him, say, Lord, save me, and he will. Yeah, he'll in no wise turn away anyone that'll come to him. Oh, we say yes, Lord. Jesus, I call on you. Lord, forgive me. Lord, I believe you were raised from the dead. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There's no greater important prayer you'll ever pray in your lifetime than when you call on Jesus and ask him to forgive you. Somebody say, he's answering. Somebody's asking and he's answering. The angels are rejoicing in heaven over one that repents. Luke 19:10. I feel it in my soul. He's answering. He's forgiven somebody. He's having mercy on somebody. Yeah, he's showing his love towards somebody right here tonight. You ain't messed up too much for his grace. You ain't went too far that he can't save you. You have did so wrong that he wouldn't forgive you if you asked him. Oh, hallelujah. That's why he died on the cross. Oh, Jesus, we believe you tonight. Thank you, Savior. Today is the day. Thank you, God. Thank you for what you're doing in these altars, Jesus. I want to assure everyone by the Spirit of the Lord, if you've asked him to forgive you, he has answered, forgiven. Everybody say it loud, forgiven. Hebrews 10:17 said it this way, your sins and iniquities I'll remember no more. That means God won't even hold it against you no more. It's like you have never, ever sinned. Lord, I thank you, according to Hebrews 9:14, you're purging consciences from dead works so they can serve the living God. God says, I'll never hold those things against you again. If you bring them back up, God will say, what are you talking about? What sin? You're forgiven. Oh, somebody ought to praise him. He's telling somebody, you're forgiven. He's cleansing somebody. Yes, he is. Oh, the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all our sin. 1 John 1:7, God said, I've let somebody feel me today. They felt me today. They've experienced my touch. Now they're experiencing my grace. God, we don't deserve it. We can't earn it. But you paid for it for us. Thank you, Lord. So we do got to receive it, and we do. We receive right now in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. Yes. You are my God. Hallelujah. Holy, holy. Mighty God. Holy Ghost. God says, I give my beloved sleep, Psalms 127:2. God says, you'll lay your head down and you'll sleep in peace. Hallelujah. And that used to keep you awake, and that used to keep you from even resting. You'll notice now that won't happen. Because God says, I'll give you rest. My presence. Exodus 33:14. God, I thank you for a peace and a sleep and a rest, God. From all that, Lord Jesus, that's just been tormenting her soul and her mind and her life. God says, tonight you've not only placed you in my hands, but now your future and your family is in my hands. Now watch what I'll do. Watch what I'll do. Watch what I'll do. Lord, I give you praise, Jesus. God, I give you glory, Jesus. God, I give you praise, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And God says, I've heard your prayers, and I've seen you ask me concerning that person that's so dear to your heart, because the enemy is trying to destroy that person before you. But God said, I have heard you, and I will rescue them. Yes, yes, I will. Fret not, says the Holy Ghost. I have heard you, and I will deliver them. What's that about? You'll have to ask her. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Oh, give him praise tonight. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. And Lord, I just pray before we leave here tonight, because we're not in a hurry. I don't mean we got to hurry up and go, but God, I just pray your divine healing presence, God, would move throughout the temples of the Holy Ghost, throughout the saints, and Lord, yes, even through sinners that may be watching somebody that's backslid. Lord, heal them so they'll turn back to you, I pray. I know everybody that gets healed don't turn back to you, but God, I pray you do it in such a way those persons would call out to you and be saved. And Lord, we just pray that you heal us, because heal us and we'll be healed. Save us, will be saved. You are our praise. Jeremiah 17:14. In the name of Jesus, you're as much our healer as you are our forgiver, our savior. And Lord, I thank you for healing bodies right now in Jesus mighty name. I give you praise for that, Lord God. Hallelujah. God, to you be the glory. God, I give you praise. God, I thank you. People are going to be able to rest. They're going to be able to sleep. Hallelujah. I know I done prayed that specifically for your daughter, our sister over here on the floor praying. But God, I thank you right now. Whatever's keeping people awake and worried and fearful, hallelujah, I thank you, Lord Jesus, that goes right now. You ain't gave us a spirit of fear, that anxiety, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. 2 Timothy 1:7, and I give you praise for that. No more, devil. We rebuke you in Jesus' name. No more, no more, no more, no more. And Lord, I pray that the inflammation in the legs, like we prayed this morning when we heard you, I hear you again. And Lord, I pray that the swelling in the lower legs and in the ankles and the feet and whatever that's about, God, I ask you to heal the saints of that. Heal them of that infirmity in their legs in Jesus' mighty name. Lord, heal that person's side where that pain is, God. God, I ask you to remove that pain out of their side, whatever it is. I'm not trying to diagnose. I'm no doctor, but Lord, I declare as your spokesman, Lord, as the one you've anointed to preach, I declare what I hear in my ear. That's what I preach on the rooftop. Yeah, Matthew 10:27, because that's all preaching is hearing. I just repeat what I hear, and I say to somebody, whatever that's going on that's happening in your side, be healed in the name of Jesus, the Son of the living God. And we give you praise for it, Lord. Thank you, God. God, help our ears to be open. Help our hearts to be open. Because, Lord, as we in Galatians 6:6 says, communicate with them who teach you in all good things. And Lord, I understand in Greek that word teacheth or teach literally translate one who speaks down into the ear. And like Pastor Tyler said, we got two ears, but Lord, we got a spirit, and that's where we hear you at. Because God, it's the spirit you've placed in man and the inspiration of the Almighty that gives him understanding. Job 32:8. So Lord, I thank you. The words we've heard tonight have not just entered our flesh ears, but Lord, they have gone down in our ear, into our spirit, where we really hear God at. Because you're a spirit. John 4:24, God's a spirit. He's Holy Spirit. And I thank you, God. Hallelujah. You speak. Only you can speak to the spirit of a man and a woman. And tonight you have done that, and we give you the glory. We give you praise. We give you honor. God, it's our prayer that you keep speaking, not only through us, but keep speaking to us, and help us to have that ear that'll hear you, an ear that'll be given to you to be able to hear what it is you're saying at this season. Hallelujah. And Lord, we know you will return soon. Help us not to forget that is the message of these latter times. Hallelujah. Let him that hath an ear hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying unto the churches. Behold, I come quickly. Oh, glory. Somebody say he's coming. Oh, I can hear it. Yeah. That's what he's saying. I'm coming. Stay ready. Keep your focus on me. Don't look back. Don't turn around. Keep your focus on me. Amen. Because it will be worth it. It will be worth it. Amen. He's coming again in Jesus' name. God's people said amen. Stay in these altars as long as you'd like. They can play some music. Has to hang around, fellowship. You need to talk with us about anything. We're not in a hurry. We're not trying to be stars. There's only room for one, and that's the morning star. That means we don't exit the building and exit the stage because we've been on the platform, and now we've got to go, you know, take care of our stardom and our famous self. No. We here for the fame of one. That's Jesus. I stand here sweaty as I am. Praise God for another hour if I need to talk with you and pray with you. Praise God. So we're not rushing out. We don't want you to. It's still daylight, believe it or not. You've witnessed a miracle at Acts 29 tonight.